Sarvadishthaya Ramakrishnayate Namah.
Suswagatam. श्री रामकृष्णांचं सार्वजनिक मंदिर प्रतिष्ठापना दिन आणि वार्षिक महोत्सवाचा आज आपला तिसरा दिवस. आजची ही पवित्र संध्याकाळ, ह्या संध्याकाळी आपण सगळे या सभागृहात जमलो आहोत. पूज्यपाद स्वामी वीरभद्रानंदजी महाराज यांचं प्रवचन ऐकण्याकरता. प्रवचनाचा आजचा विषय आहे गॉड ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंद. स्वामीजी आपले विचार इंग्रजीतनं मांडतील. मी आता स्वामीजींना विनंती करतो की त्यांनी त्यांच्या प्रवचनाला सुरुवात करावी. धन्यवाद.
हिमनाम ऋषी सखे त्वयी सर्वशक्ती आमंत्रयस्व भगवन भगदं स्वरूपं त्रैलोक्यमेतदखिलं तव पादमूले आत्मैव हि प्रभवते न जडः कदाचित्. Why do you weep, my friend? All the strength you want is already within you. Call forth the divinity within and the world shall be at your feet. Atman alone abides, never the matter.
Om.
Today is the fourth day. I share my warm feelings and also the pleasantness which I feel for having come to Pune on this wonderful occasion, taking some time to think and meditate on the message of these three great personalities. We saw from our point of view that sadhana has been the central theme, the message of Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna's life. Yesterday we came upon that sweetest thing of human life expressed through mother's life in the form of unending ceaseless love for human beings. And when that love comes pouring forth from the heart of a man who has understood the reality behind himself and behind the universe, the resultant effect will be the outpouring of love in the form of service. And that service is a message of Swami Vivekananda's life. And Swamiji has placed this service to man as service to God in front of us. And as a token of offering, I think this year's souvenir has been titled Isha Seva. Many of you might have heard about Mullah Nasiruddin. Mullah Nasiruddin was an uncommon man with uncommon common sense, wit and humor. He was a leader in the society where he was living. This mullah had a donkey with him and that donkey used to perform number of duties for him. Especially mullah had a laundry and this donkey used to carry the washed clothes. After a few years, Mullah felt perhaps this donkey has become old and it's high time that we should sell this donkey and get a new one. So one day he decided that he will go to the shandy, the market where all animals are brought and sold and left on auction. So the donkey was brought to the auction field and Mullah sold the donkey for 75 rupees. Taking that 75 rupees, Mullah went to the nearby tea stall and was having some vada pav and chai. As he was taking the tea, suddenly heard the auction calling donkey 125 rupees. Mullah was very much surprised. Which is that donkey selling for 125 rupees? I would like to purchase that donkey. And before he could finish the third sip of the tea, the rate rose and the man auctioned donkey 220 rupees, keeping the half glass of tea Mullah ran and he told immediately 250 rupees and the bid was clinched. And Mullah found that 225 rupees donkey was his own donkey. Such is the way of life. We find that in the market of life, we also sell ourselves for low prices. Caught between the experiences of sukha dukha, trials and tribulations, joys and sorrows, birth and death, success and losses, man sells himself for a lower rate, and after some time he finds he will have to pay a higher price to get back and get hold of his own self. And Kabir Das says very beautifully, "Ye sansar haat baniye ki sab jag saude aaye, chatur maal choguna kina murak mool gavayo." How beautifully he says, having come into this world of market, hundreds of things are asking our rates. What rate are you going to give for yourself? Buffeted by the laws of nature, suffering joys and sorrows, propelled by ambitions, achieving achievements and sometimes suffering failures, man thinks, "I am weak, I am poor, I am ignorant," and goes on giving values to him, and ultimately he finds that he has lost the Mooladhana. Yet in spite of all this, man very fondly holds on to his sense life, as if that is the real of all realities. And Swamiji puts it very beautifully in his Jnana Yoga, where he says, great is the tenacity with which man clings on to the senses, as if they are the real of all realities. But within a moment the whole thing vanishes, and gone are they with the wind. Hopes of lifetime, built up little by little with the energies of a great mind, vanish in a moment and gone are they. Is death the real of all realities to which we are so fondly clinging on? Even to a man who does not have a moment to inquire the credentials of his own sense pleasure, death comes and he also is compelled to ask, is death the reality of the whole life? Is death the end of all this life? Standing on the brink of a precipice beyond which there is an infinite yawning chasm, every mind, however hardened, is bound to recoil and ask, is death the end of all things? The whole world may combine together to prevent us from broadening out beyond the present, yet so long as death remains, everyone and every nation will be bound to ask, is death the end of all things? Saints die, sinners die, peasants die, beggars die, kings die. Death is the one goal towards which we all are traveling. If this is so, what is the way out for a common man? Is man a puppet in the hands of nature? Is he a boat tossed on the crest of a wave one moment and next moment thrown down on the yawning chasm below? And in the despair and deep anguish, man goes on weeping and wailing and cries to all sorts of gods and goddesses, "O God, please come and help me." Which of these gods have come to help you? Where had these gods and goddesses had gone when Britishers came and butchered you? When all the Mughals came and slaughtered you, where these gods and goddesses went? These gods, to whom we so fondly kneel down and worship, they never guard us against any problems. When death and sorrow, agony and anguish are constantly staring at our face every moment, which god comes to your help? All these gods come to you when you are successful. What is the use of worshipping all these gods when suffering is the end, when death is the end of our life? Yet man very fondly holds on to all these things, puts the hands on his own eyes and cries bitterly, "O Lord, where will the help come?" In this desperation, when the cry went to the throne of mercy, then a voice responded, "There is a way beyond and behind all this darkness. If you know that man who is beyond all this darkness and death, one who is full of light, you shall cross the ocean of misery." And that one, the one full of light, one beyond the ocean of misery and death, is your own real nature, the Atman, the one infinite reservoir of immense energy and power. Man in his utter foolishness and ignorance thinks he is body and he is mind. Associating himself with all the experiences that are connected with the body and mind, man goes on crying, I am weak, I am a sinner, I am impure, I die, I am born. Remove your hand and behold the light. Immense energy of the Atman will flood your whole fields of life, and infinite success will mark the beginning of a new life. But man thinks his body. Society nurtures this idea. The field of education fondly furnishes this idea that man is body, man is mind. This body to which we are fondly holding is not our real self. The body comes and the body goes, it is born and it dies. Every moment our body is undergoing change. But moment we think of ourselves, we say we are this body. I feel I am Swami Virbhadrananda, 5 feet 6 inches, 80 kgs in weight. And each one of us associate ourselves with the body and accordingly picturize and give value to us. Not knowing our Mooladhana, in this market, we pay a price according to our own estimation, associating ourselves with this body and mind. This body constantly changes. Never it is permanent. If you watch the photographs of your own self at the age of 5, 15, 25, 50 and 85, none of these photographs seem similar. And yet we say, this is myself. What is that which is behind the changing bodies, but which is not the changing body, yet constantly asserts that I am this, I am this. As we pass on our research, we find that this body is motivated and propelled by something which is superior. And that force is called mind, which is acting and making the mind body act and creating a feeling that we ourselves are the body. All of us are so fond of this body, is it not? How much time we spend in front of the mirror? Everyone wants to look beautiful. At least he wants to make others seem that he is beautiful. But reality behind is not known to him. Similarly, he is his dealings with his mind, the changing modes of mind, constantly varying like the passing clouds in front of the sky. Man constantly associates with the changing moods, the changing vagaries of the mind, and feels he is sorrowful, he is miserable, sometimes he is bored, sometimes he is frightened, sometimes he says, I am in a jubilant mood. If this mind is constantly changing, who is the one remaining unchanged behind the changing mind and creating a link behind all these moods? Films fall on a screen and constantly all the scenes on the film are changing, yet we feel there is a continuity. What is it that is creating the sense of continuity in the changing body and changing mind? You may be wondering, what is the connection between this and God of Vivekananda? Swamiji says in his chapter on the real and apparent man, the body is not yourself, the mind is not yourself. Thoughts are constantly passing in front of your mind, you remain without passing. If you are the body, after every year you would have died, but you don't die. The body is constantly changing, it's a changing phenomenon. So that is clear that we are not the body. So when the body is feverish, we are not feverish. When the body has got diabetes, we don't have diabetes. When the body is having blood pressure, we say, I am having blood pressure, is it not? See, look at the beauty. How this identification, a wrong identification is constantly acting in our life, and because of that wrong identification, hundreds of gods and goddesses are invented in our life. This is one of the approach of Vedanta, and while talking about this in America, Swamiji says, don't get frightened. Your gods and goddesses may be thrown overboard. The temples may be simply thrown away. All your fond philosophies, shastras, stotras, everything may be thrown away. But then that is the most logical God which Vedanta places in front of man. The changing body and the changing mind. Who connects this? All this change which we see are always relative. No change, no movement can take place independently. If there is a train which is running, there must be the stationary platform and the stationary railway line. If the platform also moves along with the train, what will happen? So if it's one of our thoughts, if we also move away, what would have happened? 8 to 8.30, I was feeling frightened because tomorrow there is an examination. After 8.30, my uncle comes and meets. He says, here is the question paper which has been leaked out. The fear goes away. But I don't go away. I stay there. Immediately I feel a sense of confidence. Yes, the leaked out question paper has come. Now I shall prepare. Then the mood has changed. The thought in the form of fear has gone away. After half an hour, somebody comes, one of my friends, and he steals away the question paper. I become absolutely angry, mad with anger. I want to beat that boy. Now the fear which has moved away from the mind and the joy which I got after receiving the question paper also has moved away from the mind, but I have not moved away because I am not the thought, I am not the mind. Like the clouds passing away, but the sky remains, there is some entity, some force which is constantly staying and creating a link and because of which memory stays. If I also go on moving along with the thought, along with the changes of mind, I would not be there next moment to recognize that I am Virbhadrananda. For a moment I was frightened, for a moment I was joyful, and next moment I became absolutely angry. So which of these is Virbhadrananda? And at night when I go to sleep, the whole universe vanishes. My father, my mother, my status, my name, my glory, my fame, my property, everything vanishes. All the gods and goddesses also vanish. And yet early morning I come back as the same Virbhadrananda. Suresh goes to sleep, but he never returns back as Mahesh. He comes back as Suresh. So there is something unchanging, eternal, which is undying. And that is your real nature, Swamiji says. The one which is unchanging, unborn, undying, without the shadow of death and disease, without misery, without happiness, that is the nature of your soul, called Satchidananda, which is a reservoir of infinite knowledge, infinite bliss, infinite strength and infinite power. If that be so, what makes us in our life cringe and crawl behind all these goddesses and gods and make us constantly appeal to them for fulfilling our desires? Vedanta says, the one voice which propelled you into action, you heard that voice. That was right. But the direction you had given is absolutely wrong. The voice came from inside. It was your own nature, infinite existence, and therefore you want to stay forever. Immortality is your nature. And therefore we pray to God, oh God, may I never die. And if possible, we take life insurance. But none of these insurances can give us assurance against death. We die. In spite of paying all our policies, we die. Somebody else enjoys. The voice we are hearing is constantly our own voice, but the direction we give is wrong. Swamiji gives a beautiful simile. He says, there was a man in the forest. He was sleeping inside the room and there was a knock on the door. He thought somebody is outside. He went and opened and found nobody. Again and again it happened. After some time he found that knock was not on the door. It was his own heartbeat. So the God within you is himself calling you again and again, but in our own ignorance, because of our own inability, we feel that the voice is coming from outside and we go on searching outside. Navi kamalame hai kasturi jaise mirag phire bhramakari. Kabirdas says, bina sad guru nar aise hi dunde jaise mirag phire banakari. So man is constantly wandering here and there like this deer in whose navi that great musk is there, but this deer is going on wandering here and there. Therefore, we who want knowledge, we create a Saraswati, go on putting all garlands, flowers and all worships, and we say, O Devi, give us knowledge, give us knowledge, give us knowledge. All the knowledge is already inside you, Swamiji says. Where was the law of gravitation? Was it in the apple? Was it in earth? It was in the brain of Newton. Where was the theory of relativity? Did Einstein ever bow down to Saraswati and pray, O Mother, give me knowledge? Applied his own immense energy, immense knowledge, immense power, and then the result was E equal to MC squared. The man who wants energy, he creates Parashakti. And he says, O Mother, give me Shakti. He who wants wealth, creates Lakshmi, and he says, Mother, give me wealth. Whoever told that money makes man? It is man who makes money. This being the state of things, with what a pitiable nature that man is crawling like a worm on this earth. Seeing this condition of man, Swamiji wept and wept for this condition of man. What a pathetic sight it is. What a tragedy. God himself is living and yet he is behaving like a worm. It is because, Swamiji says, you do not know your own real nature. Therefore, teach yourselves, teach everyone his real nature. Call upon the sleeping soul and see how it awakes. Purity will come, power will come, glory will come, goodness will come. All that is excellent shall come when that sleeping soul is awakened to self-conscious activity. What wonderful message. God is sleeping inside. Yesterday we saw the God with immense energy, tremendous potentialities and possibilities is always sleeping inside, but we refuse to see the God inside and we want to see God outside because that is more comfortable and convenient. Moment we take the responsibility and remove the gods and goddesses from outside, all the burden of self-effort falls on our own shoulders. And man wants comfort, never the truth. And Krishna says, Sukham Bandhat Pramuchyate, comfort binds, truth liberates. Someone lady in the western countries asked, Swami, you are constantly speaking something which is terrible and harsh. Tell us something comfortable. Swamiji told, Madam, truth will not give you comfort. Truth will liberate you on the contrary. But who wants liberation? Caught like camels and dogs, we want to chew the same bone and suck the blood of our own gums. Caught within the inextricable web of the nature, on one side giving desire in the mind, at the same time creating an adamantine wall beyond which the senses and the intellect and the mind cannot go, man is in a tremendously desperate condition. And therefore he falls at the feet of the gods and goddesses. Swami says, which god came to help you? Uddhare Atman Atmanam Natmanam Avasadaye. You are your own friend. You are your own greatest enemy. Moment you say you are weak, you are ignorant, you are poor. Poor you become, ignorant you become, weak you become. One may ask, is there no weakness in life? Swamiji says, yes. But can weakness cure weakness? Can dirt wash dirt? Therefore, the only remedy is to preach to mankind the glorious nature of his own soul. Infinite power, infinite knowledge and infinite energy is lurking behind you. Yet you creep in front of all these gods and goddesses and go on praying, O Lord, help me, help me. Have you ever found that in the greatest crisis of your life, you are alone? And in spite of all the gods and goddesses, tsunamis and earthquakes of Latur and Gujarat come, have we not found out that in spite of all the gods and goddesses, our prayers, death comes, disease comes, sorrow comes, misery comes, agony comes, pain comes. What then happens to all these gods and goddesses? Swamiji says, stand on the might of your own self. The whole universe pales into insignificance in front of the mighty nature of your own self. That is your real nature, the Atman, the one without a second. Which scientist has ever found out the infinite power lurking behind the mortal frame of yours? Like the infinite ocean behind the tidal and the small wave, irrespective of whether you are a Brahmana or a Shudra, rich or poor, educated or ignorant, there is infinite Atman assuring infinite possibilities and infinite success. Therefore, call upon the sleeping soul and see how it awakens. This Atman has to be preached to mankind, Swamiji says. Let man understand that there is no God in this world except his own self. In the beginning, man feels there is a God outside. He says, God is separate and I am separate. As he goes on worshipping the God, slowly he finds that I am part of God. And after some time, he says, I don't want any God, I am myself God. Tattvamasi. That thou art already. But you only put your hand in front of the eyes and cry, it is darkness, it is darkness. Remove the hand and behold the splendorous nature of your own self. That wonderful Atman, constantly assuring infinite possibilities and infinite success. This Atman, which is your own nature, is beyond the name and form, unchangeable. This Atman is in all, interpenetrating the whole universe. This Atman is there, therefore the universe is there. Sun and the stars and the moon, they all shine because of your own Atman. Even in Bhakti Sahitya, it is accepted. One day Vishnu gave a darshan to Prahlada. Seeing the wonderful image of Prahlada, Vishnu, Prahlada asked, O Lord, why is that your Karuna Kundala, it is not moving? Vishnu told, Hey Prahlad, tum hilaoge to hilega. It is because of you the whole universe is existing. Forgetting that God, we run after statues, temples, holy spots, pictures of God and everything. Man creates God. Swamiji says, God created man after his image and man created God after his own image. In Bombay we used to see huge pictures drawn on the road, Hanuman, Shiva, Rama, and people will throw coins. The chalk piece, he will draw a beggar. Then I used to ask, first God created, then this beggar is creating God now. And all are going and worshipping that God. Look at the tragedy, the paradox of the human mind. God is inside and yet we are seeking God outside. And how much amount of money is poured in temples on the holy spots for purchasing holy books? I used to tell in India, gods are rich and men are poor. Really, if you go to Kanchipuram, Varadaraja Perumal, bedecked with all the diamonds and jewelries, and outside you will find a man begging for his food. God is rich and man is poor. And who is making that God rich? Men like us. Is it not? Therefore, Swamiji says, teach this truth to mankind, that he is God, he is Atman, but the body and mind will rebel. He says, however the body rebels, however the mind rebels, in the uttermost darkness, in the deepest gloom, in the darkest despair, tell it once, twice, thrice, evermore, I am it, Shivoham, Shivoham, Shivoham. Many days I have been without food, starving, footsore, weary, I could scarcely walk. I used to sink under a tree, life seemed to be ebbing away, but then my mind would revert to that idea that I am that, I am that. Arise, O Lord of Lords, God of Gods, regain your lost empire, arise, walk and stop not. Today here I am lecturing, Swami Vivekananda says. Therefore, whenever there is darkness in your life, give the sledgehammer blow that I am that, I am that, Shivokam, Shivokam. Mountain high, though the difficulties may seem, they are but maya. Dark and gloomy, though the situation may appear, they are but dream. Fear not, it is vanished. Crush it, it vanishes. Stamp upon it, it dies. You may pray to all the 100,000s of gods, which Englishman and everybody is inventing. But who will come to your help? You are your own help. Helpless you are born and helpless you die. Do not mind these failures in your life, my son. Make efforts again and again. These failures are like the oasis in the desert of your life. Assert the reality and everything adverse must vanish. Must is the word, Swamiji says. I am the Atman. Nature cannot crush me. Nature is my servant. You may feel again and again, but again onward you march. Push ahead again and again. Light will come slowly, but surely it comes. Repeat it again and again that Shivokam, Shivokam, Shivokam. I am that, I am that. Faint and imperceptible, though the voice may appear in the beginning, a time will come when you will gain strength and roar like a lion and tell, I am the Atman, the one without infinite second. I have no death, I have no birth, no fear, no father, no mother, no misery, no gloom, nothing. I am ever free, the one without a second, the unchanging reality. And he who sees this one in the many, the unchanging reality in the changing universe, to him belongs peace and eternal liberation, eternal joy. This knowledge has to be preached to mankind, Swamiji says. This Atman has to be taught to mankind that there is no great God in this world other than the Atman. Man is the greatest God that ever existed. Man is the greatest God that will ever exist. This Atman has to be first heard of, then thought upon, and then meditated. Let this knowledge of the Atman resonate in your mind 24 hours. Let it enter into your brain, into your bones, into your veins and tickle in every drop of your blood. And from them, that will come knowledge, infinite energy and power. This is the advent of immortality, the end of all. Swamiji says, he who sees his own self, the Atman in everybody, what happens to him?
Yastu sarvani bhutani, atmanyeva anupashyati, sarva bhuteshu cha atmanam tatovana vijigupsate. Can you ever hate another man when you find your own Atman is pervading that man also? The same self is spread everywhere. That is the opening of the fountain of love, Swamiji says. When you see the same soul pervading the whole universe, the whole creation is God, but man is the Taj Mahal of creation. If you cannot find God in man, where can you find God? In the granite stone? There is a beautiful saying in Tamil, Nattakal pesumo nadan ullirikail. It's a terrific phrase. Are patthar baat karega, prabhu jab bheetar mein hai. Then another siddha sings, the same granite stone I took, broke into two pieces, one I made Vithoba and another I made the footstep on the entrance. Which is more holy, please tell? Vithoba is holy or that stone is holy? Both of them I have carved from the same granite. But man in his utter foolishness says that is Vithoba and this is stepping stone. He steps here and he worships that. But the Lord is inside us. If we can ever understand this glorious nature of our own soul, and find that the same God is there everywhere. And if you can understand and really catch it at the intellectual level, the first result and effect will be the release of immense love for mankind. Leaving that, we seek God in temples, in the books. Once Swamiji asked, how dare you confine the infinite God within the few pages of your book? God is in your book. Never. God is inside you. The very mind which is uttering the mantra, it is uttering the mantra because of the God inside, is it not? The very tongue which is singing glory of the God, that tongue is singing because the God is inside my mind, my heart, behind my body. Yan manasana manupe, yenahuhu manomatam, tadeva brahmatvam viddi, naidam yaridam upasate, not what you worship here. The great mantra of my tongue is uttering, that utterance comes because of the God which is inside me. Once you catch sight of this Atman which is inside and understand the infinite nature and that he himself is pervading the whole universe, Swamiji says the resultant effect of that heart is the release of unending love. Tato navijugupsate, that man can never hate another man. And when such a reaction comes, what will be the nature of our life? Continuous service for mankind. Our worship will take the form of service. Because wherever we turn, it is our own self, our own Atman. The misery of the universe is my misery. The sorrow of the universe is my sorrow. Their pain and anguish is my pain and anguish. One day when Swamiji was going for a morning walk, suddenly he saw an old lady carrying a huge log of wood. She fell down and she was injured on the rib. The people who were walking with Swamiji could not see that. Suddenly Swamiji cried, oh the pain, oh the pain, oh the pain. The people who were walking with Swamiji asked, Swamiji, where is the pain? What happened? Did you not see the old lady with a huge bundle of firewood falling down and injuring her rib? Yes, that is the pain here. Look at the marvelous state of human existence. To what staggering heights the human life can be lifted. And Swamiji says, 3,000 years of duality has made whole India a confused lot. Give Vedanta a new try. When the nectar is flowing, why do you make people drink dishwater? Let man hear of the glorious nature of his own self. Teach to them from the childhood that he is the Atman, he is the self. And let him search this God inside man. If you cannot worship that God in man, where can you worship him? Moko kahan se dhoonde bande, mai to tere paas mein, na mandir mein, na masjid mein, na kashi, na kailash mein. But what we do? We want to build a temple for God in Ayodhya. Is it not? And all of us are dying. And Kabir Das says, are bande murak, mai to tere hi paas mein. And that God which is inside me is everywhere. And is wandering the whole world. And what a pity. What the irony of our existence, you see. God is wandering in front of us and forgetting that we create a new God. Every day new temples are coming, new gods are created. Somebody created a god called Katkateshwar. He told, what is this Katkateshwar? He told, we have started a new typing institute, so we have created a god. As we type Katkateshwar, he becomes Katkateshwar. So hundreds of gods and goddesses are created. When living, vibrating, dynamic God is sitting in front of us, can you not behold the Lord in them? From Sri, from Puman, from Kumara Utava Kumari, from Dando Jiranena Vanchasi, from Jato Bhavati Vishwato Mukaha. In the young man, the young girl, in the old man tottering the old age on his sticks, thou art there. This may be a tough job. Swami says, why not start it now itself? Why do you bother about the Dvaita and other things? So far we have given a try for Dvaita. Let us start this Advaitic Vedanta now. Currently there is a fear, wave of fear in the country. Let this message of Advaita Vedanta spread that man himself is the Atman, the God, and that God is everywhere. The one without a second, infinite, formless God. And if this is not a logical God, which God will be logical? And in one of the most refined sentiments which a human heart can express, Swamiji says, Bahurupe Sammukhe Thomar. What a marvelous expression. Bahurupe Sammukhe Thomar. Chadi Kotaik Mujeche Ishwar. Are Murak. Kitne Rupo Me Tumhare Samne Mai Ghumta Firta Chal Raha Hu. Ise Chodkar Bhagawan Ko Kahan Dhoond Rahe Ho Tum. Then the most marvelous sentiments are released in the next line. I have repeated that statement hundreds of times. Je Jon Kore Jive Prem. Bahurupe Samuke Tomar, Ye Chari Kotai Konjecho Ishwar, Je Jon Kore Jive Prem. What marvelous statement, you see. Shei Shei Ishwar. He who loves Jiva, Je Jon Kore Jive Prem. Yesterday we saw in Mother's life, Je Jon Kore Jive Prem, Shei Shei Ishwar. So this is the message of Swamiji. God is in front of you, living as mother, father, guru, atithi, as a poor man, as a downtrodden, as wicked, as miserable, leaving all this. You try to find that God in your Brahma Sutra, in your Gita, in your Upanishad. Where is that God? He is in front of you. Can you not see? Can you not take this as the sadhana? This is the method of Vedanta. In the olden days, when there was no printing press and paper, do you think they will be reading all these Upanishads? All these things came from inside, is it not? The infinite library is inside you. The whole Shastras has come out from our own mind, our own antakarana. So God is there, present everywhere. One day in Belurma, Swamiji was sitting early morning. Swami Premanandaji was going to worship with Kamandalu in his hand, and there was a woman sweeping the steps of Belurma temple. Suddenly Swamiji cried out, here is Brahman, here is Brahman. Can you not see? Brahman is here itself. There was a tremendous transformation in the whole atmosphere. The whole area became charged, surcharged with the power of Swamiji's realization. Swami Premananda stood there like a statue on the steps of Belurma temple. The woman who was sweeping the steps, she became like a painted picture. Everything became still and silent, and there was a wonderful vibration of the Brahman, the Atman in every being. After some time, suddenly Swamiji smiled and told, now you can go. So that is the service, the God which Swamiji saw, and the service Swamiji wanted to render to mankind. After all the austerities in the world, I have found out one truth. There is no God in this world, he puts a comma, except man. Look at the expression, you see. Most of the time we try to hoodwink or bypass or overlook these statements because they are not very comfortable for us. They are not very easy to practice. To think that my scavenger is God, are you going to accept that? Tomorrow is going to ask a bonus. Are you willing to give that bonus? Increase in the salary to that God? Immediately God becomes a dog. But Swamiji says, if you want to really practice spirituality, Vedanta must enter into your life, every moment. And that was the purpose, the mission of Swamiji's life. He says to Nivedita, and I quoted that letter yesterday, the world is in need of those whose life is one burning love, selfless. In the beginning he says, my mission indeed can be put into few words, and that is to preach unto mankind their inherent divinity and how to make it manifest in every moment of their life. Worship, good. Chanting stotras, good. Reading shastras, good. But to practice seeing God in man, that is really fantastic. And that is the need of the day, need of the hour. If America can see God in Iraq people, in South African people, what a transformation it can create. Once I told in one meeting, if the American president can be presented with the complete works of Swami Vivekananda, with this message of Advaita Vedanta, and suppose if his mind catches fire, if our own neighboring country whose president came for the cricket match, suppose if his mind catches this idea that God is in man, what will happen? Swamiji says, you will be struck dumb to find that through everybody's hand you are working, through everybody's mouth you are speaking, and through everybody's legs you are walking. Sahasra Shirsha Purushaha. To his disciple Sharachandra Chakravarti, he says, my son, constantly let this idea that you are the Atman, Shivoham, Shivoham, let it resonate and reverberate in your mind again and again. After some time, all the crookedness of the heart will vanish, all the doubts will be cleared, and all the misery will cease, and then you will find that the God which is inside you is inside everywhere. This is the cup of love. This is one panacea for all the evils of the society. And then when that love comes, Swamiji says, it will be one outpouring love of service. Jag ki seva, jagadish ki seva. So where do we want to worship God? Leaving all these people? We want to run into the forest, into the cave? And Swamiji brought that transcendental reality with the extraordinary genius of his own into the day-to-day life. For us, Brahman, the reality is unreal. This is actual. This actual and that real must combine and mingle to form a wonderful synthesis of practical wisdom. Swamiji brought that real into this actual. That is transcendental, this is phenomenal. That transcendental Brahman must mingle with the day-to-day life. And Swamiji put it in one of the most beautiful orientation of Vedanta by telling, man himself is God. And when you understand that you are God, what you will do? You pay a very good value and again purchase yourself back and come. Like that Mullah Nasruddin, who brought his own donkey for a higher price. Now we can understand what Kabir says, a samsara heart baniye ki sab jag sode aaye. So many experiences are the contractors, sode. They are asking, give me your life, give me your mind, give me your knowledge, and we are constantly paying the price. I am like this, I am like that. Chatur mal choguna kina murak mool gavayo. So the moola dhana, the mool, the capital is my own self. If I lose myself, I will lose God also. So this man is the God of Vivekananda. More and more you approach your God Vivekananda, or as I approach Swami Vivekananda, who is my God, more and more I go near to my God Vivekananda, I found Vivekananda slowly disappearing, and I am lifted and kept as God. I found I am myself God. Ultimately, perhaps Vivekananda will disappear and God alone will remain. I also will disappear. And to serve that God is the purpose of our life. And this is the message Swamiji gave in the Rameshwaram, which has been put down in the temple entrance. He who worships Jiva, he really worships Shiva. So that is the God of Vivekananda. And that is the God Swamiji presents to us. Would you like to worship that God? Then as soon as you go to your house, you will find father has become God. Mother has become God. Wife has become God. Husband has become God. Mischievous children have become God. The servant has become God. Everybody has become God. And what a tremendous challenge it is going to be. But if we are really followers of Swami Vivekananda, we must accept this challenge. Yes, Swamiji, Jai Jon Kore, Jive, Prem. See, love for Jiva. Swamiji is not uttering the word Shiva. Jai Jon Kore, Jive, Prem. Can you love man? We talk of high philosophies, extraordinary theories. But when it comes to day-to-day practical life, every moment there is quarrel. What happened to that Jive, Prem? How easy is it not? It seems it is difficult, but it is not impossible. Therefore, Swamiji again and again he says, let this idea enter into your veins, enter into your bones, till it mingles and rings with every drop of your blood. May the fiery power and personality of Swami Vivekananda inspire us to such higher modes of thinking and living. So I feel extremely happy to be here. I convey my warm feelings and reverence to revered Bhagavanji Maharaj, to have given this opportunity to come and talk about my own Prabhu. I am benefited, I feel I am blessed, and I feel I have become purified, my chitta is purified by meditating on these great personalities for these 4 days. So I pray to Bhagavan Sri Ramakrishna, Swamiji and Mother to open the doors of the heart so that we may fulfill the mission for which they have come. May we be an instrument in their hands. Hari Om Tat Sat.